This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Good to see y'all here this morning on this Sunday. We had some interesting email correspondence this week. You know, when you celebrate both Reformation Sunday and All Saints, very few churches do both, but we're one of the ones that do both. We're never sure which Sunday is which. Some websites say one, some say the other. So because Halloween is next weekend, I was choosing All Saints for next weekend. So that's when we'll be doing All Saints is for next Sunday. This Sunday is Reformation Sunday. And so when you're choosing hymns, you know, we've got a mighty fortress as our God. We don't want to sing that on the wrong Sunday. So we had some good exchange this morning. So happy Reformation Sunday. That is the Sunday we're celebrating today. But if your Presbyterian ministers say, if your Presbyterian friends say that it was totally wrong, or Lutheran friends, then just understand the dynamic. We don't combine them all on the same Sunday. But it's good to have you all here. A couple of announcements. Mark your calendar for December 1st. We're going to be decorating the lock on December 1st, 5 o'clock, I think. Is that the new time? 5:30? I think the
5 o'clock.
5 o'clock, we're going to start that. Because I think we want to decorate as much as we can before the punch kicks in. So we want to make sure that it's all there. So we're having a party with the decorating. That's a Wednesday evening, the 1st. And so mark your calendar. Plan on coming. We should have a great time. So do mark that piece with it. Also, November the 10th, which is in 2 weeks, 2 weeks. There's an event that's going to be over at Susan Coker's house. She's going to be having something, I think it's at 3 p.m. on the 10th. It's all in your newsletter. All the information's there. But if you can go and be a part of that, hope you'll mark your calendars for that as well. So two upcoming events. Please keep those two pieces in mind. November the 10th, both are on Wednesday, and then December 1st.
You can't get the book for November the 10th.
I'm sorry, what?
You are not able to get the book for November.
Is that right? Well, then come, have you not read? So don't worry about the reading. You know, come on, because I think it's more fellowship than not, and they can extend the book discussion to a later date. So Amazon's just not, they can't do next day delivery.
They sent me the journal, they sent me this study guide, and we tried again, we've ordered the book again.
Well, okay, good. Well, we'll make sure that that everybody's aware that the book's not being read by folks until later. So we'll make sure that piece is there. I hope y'all can, your calendar will permit you all to be at both places. We're gonna start this morning with the singing of A Mighty Fortress Is Our God. It's hymn number 110, if you'll stand and sing.
He amid the flood,
did. Just remember on that particular hymn, you always want to sing all four verses because there's a storyline going through it. So I hope you realize that if you were not familiar, you go back through and read, not true of all hymns, but that hymn goes through the whole piece. You want to make sure you realize that as you sing it. I should have said that beforehand. Today's text is just one simple verse, a verse that's important though, because it's an important verse we should always remember. John chapter 8, verse 36, coming from the Common English Bible. And this is a wonderful verse in relation to Reformation Sunday. Therefore, if the Son makes you free, that is S-O-N, if the Son makes you free, you really will be free. And today we're going to be talking about freedom, and we say thanks be to God for that text. As we move into our time of prayer, we'll take a moment of silence, giving us a chance to voice concerns that we have directly to God and to hear God's voice, speaking to directly to each one of us individually. And then I'll open us up in a congregational prayer, and then we'll close with the Lord's Prayer. So let us bow in a moment of silence. We've gathered once again, O God, in this place to come and to worship you. And on this Reformation Sunday, O Lord, we remember 500 years ago when Martin Luther took the stand and nailed the thesis on the door at Wittenberg and proclaimed the need for the church to reform. And then later, the Roman Catholic Church counter-reforming and truly changing because of his efforts as well. So not only the birth of the Protestant movement, but also the Reformation of the Catholic movement. We realize, Lord, that there are times we need to stand and proclaim truth. And there are times, oh Lord, that we need to dig deep into the foundational aspects of our faith. And even when there's opposition against us, even when the official religious body excommunicates us, we're willing to stand and to be counted and to do what we need to do. So Lord, help us, even in this day, to be willing to stand and to proclaim your truth, to live our lives in ways, Lord, that truly exemplify that truth, that we're not just talking about it, but that we actually live it. And we live the truth that comes from Scripture, and that it can truly penetrate through our lives and impact others. So today, Lord, we honor Martin Luther and his efforts. And we pray that if there are ways that the church needs to reform now, this post-pandemic dynamic, in ways that we here at Lake Oconee Community Church need to reform and to be changed. Forgive us, Lord, when we fight against change just because we don't like it, or we fight it because we're uncomfortable. Forgive us, Lord, when we're not open to the Spirit and the Spirit's leading and to hear new voices coming and new understandings, and to bring new people to the table. Forgive us, Lord, when we're not out there living a vibrant faith and allowing it to intersect with the society that we live in. So on this Sunday, Lord, help us to remember all of that, all of Martin Luther's life, and help it to serve as a model for us, as a challenge, as a goal to set in our own lives. And help us to truly be willing to pay the cost, pay the price of whatever it is to live life that way. Bless all of our efforts. Keep us together as a church community and help us to love one another and to be there to support one another whenever in need. Help us to be reaching out to the community, and again, individually and collectively, making a difference here in this Lake Oconee area and beyond. And may all that we do bring honor and glory to you, and may you count us as your faithful servants in all of our endeavors. We pray all of this in the name of Jesus, the one who taught us to pray. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The search for freedom has been an ongoing one throughout all of history. Wars have been fought to fight back oppressive forces and to restore freedom to people who felt the weight of tyranny and cruelty and even rule by foreign sources outside of them. Several years ago when I visited Ireland, it was interesting the evidence that's all over that country of the struggle that the Irish had for freedom with the monuments and the plaques on very significant spots. And it wasn't hard for us to be mistaken as being English when we were there. That was until I opened my mouth and they realized I was not from England. We don't have to go to history books to see the struggle for freedom, because even in this day, we see people struggling for freedom. The Syrian situation, for instance, several years back, and people trying to get across the border to a place where there's safety. More recently, the Afghanistan dynamic, and watching folks look for the freedom that they did in relation to the Taliban, trying to get out of that country so that they can live life as a normal family, or at least as normal as possible, even if they have to walk halfway across Europe or fly around the world. Oh, to the hospital patient, freedom means release from a hospital bed and having good health once again. To the addicted, and we heard this on July 4th, amongst us, those in the recovery process, the addicted, for them, freedom means no more reliance on substances to feel good or to deal with the world. Even to those who are unhappy at work or they're overworked, freedom means getting a job that they can really enjoy, have some time off with family, or even do a hobby. In the second half of the last century, though, there arose kind of a new idea about freedom. That is, freedom is doing what you please. And there was kind of a blurring of distinction between right and wrong, to the point that sometimes wrong was regarded as right. People claimed that they were free from any of the old taboos or old restrictions that might be there. Pop culture has absorbed a lot of that and has promoted drugs that have been detrimental to people's lives, pornography, murdering folks in violence and robbery and greed and selfishness. All of this has kind of been absorbed in pop culture. We see it on television. It's become a norm as we watch. And in some ways, these are shown as new expressions of the new freedom. Somewhere, parents stopped teaching the values that needed to pass on, believing that their children should be free from any kind of old ways. And instead, they just given to a new slavery, and that would be self-centeredness in a lot of ways. So today in the text that we read, we hear about Jesus talking about freedom. First he says, the truth will set you free. Now if I went out to the street and said, friend, hey, I wanted to tell you something really important. Do you believe that you're a free person? You're not. It's the truth that sets you free. Well, I'm sure the person would think that I'm nuts by going and telling them they're not free. They would walk away, or they'd probably say, we live in a free country, of course I'm free. You don't know what you're talking about. And you see, Jesus' Jewish listeners thought the same way. They were descendants of Abraham. This gave them a privileged position with God, and they need not fear of any punishment for any sin. And then Jesus reminds his listeners, I'll tell you the truth. Everyone who sins is a slave to sin. The people don't like to be reminded of that. They think the church harps on sin too much oftentimes. And they say they don't like talking about sin and sickness and death when they come to church. They think church should be a happy place. This whole idea of being slavery to sin is an old-fashioned concept in the modern church. But the reality is we can't deny Jesus' words here. To be a slave of sin is serious stuff. For you see, a slave is controlled by someone else. And in this case, it's sin that controls us. A slave is a slave for all of life. And we are bound to the sin all of our lives. Everyone who sins is a slave to sin. That's what Jesus says. He doesn't leave much room for any doubt here. There's an ongoing action of sinning intended in this language, not just for individual sinful actions, but a lifestyle, a slavery. Slavery is a lifestyle. It is a way of life, something from which you and I, we cannot escape. There's a moment in our lives that sin doesn't, there isn't a moment in our lives when sin doesn't dictate to us at what we can do. Oftentimes, a symbol for slavery are chains or shackles. Those are high symbols for that. And they bind and they restrict freedom. They can't be removed. They cause pain. They're constant reminders that our whole being belongs to someone else. And in this case, to something else. The Bible says sin. A slave can't break his or her own chains and be really free. Even if he or she should somehow break the chains, a slave is still a slave. This is the human dilemma. Oh, you can go to self-improvement classes. You can attend counseling sessions if you want to try to improve your behavior. You can go through therapy groups to try to be more positive and less influenced by our sinful nature. We might distinguish between big sins and little sins and say the little ones don't count. But none of these change what Jesus says. Everyone who sins is a slave to sin. Well, it was in the 16th century that Martin Luther, he found himself in a church that provided an elaborate self-improvement scheme with the promise of giving people personal freedom. Freedom from sin was offered in all kinds of shapes and sizes. And Luther was caught up in trying to make right all the wrongs. That is, to get rid of his chains of slavery. But in spite of the assurances from the highest levels of church authority of that day, the words of Jesus still stood. Everyone who sins is a slave of sin. No self-improvement scheme was going to break those chains. What Jesus says next brings some relief. It's not the slave who frees himself, for Jesus says, if the Son sets you free, you are free indeed. You are truly free. It is the Son, Jesus Christ, who breaks the shackles and breaks the chains, and by doing that, changes the relationship between the slave and the master. The slave is no longer a slave, but instead becomes a son or becomes a daughter. The Son declares us free. It's only the Son of God who can do this. Now, some of us learned this in Sunday school class. Some of us learned this in confirmation class. You all remember memorizing those words. How many Lutherans do we have in the group that learned Luther's small catechism? How many? Any? Some in the room, maybe. A few, okay. It's been a while, I realize. It's been a while. But remember Luther's small catechism. At great cost, he has saved and redeemed us, a lost and condemned person. He has freed me from sin, death, and the power of the devil, not with silver or gold, but with his holy and precious blood and his innocent suffering and death. All this he has done that I may be his own. I'm sure I didn't fully appreciate those words, even when I was in seminary learning it for the first time. I don't remember, and of course didn't recite it as a child. But I can just imagine being the young child. I have had Lutheran friends who the kids have been memorizing that, you know, the day before the confirmation class and when they have to give it. It's loaded. It is loaded with depth and meaning. In fact, Luther's explanation of the Apostles' Creed as a whole is one of the finest statements of Christian faith, and it is well worth revisiting. All you got to do is Google it, and I would encourage you to revisit it. The truth will set you free, Jesus said. At Jesus' trial, Pontius Pilate asked Jesus, well, what is the truth? Well, here it is. The marvelous, extraordinary, mind-blowing truth that God had come to earth and muddied himself with all of the worldly filth in order to break the chains and shackles of sin that bind every human being. Jesus came to rescue us. He came to rescue us from the slavery of sin. He doesn't dismiss sin as irrelevant. He doesn't make excuses on our behalf. No, he came to break sin's power over us. He gave his life for us on the cross to free us from the power that sin and the evil one have over us. God shatters the chains of sin and declares you and me holy and clean. Jesus restores friendship with us. He claims us as his sons and daughters. He forgives us, even though you and I, we don't deserve it. This is grace. And grace is a gift that is grasped in truth. The freedom that Christ gives us, it fills us with hope. There is a life that breaks the shackles of sin, that wears us down, and the chains of evil that calls us to be ashamed of the way that we carry on and keep living. But there's a hope that breaks the manacles of depression and of sickness and of ongoing medical treatment. The love of a Savior calls us his own friends, and he will not leave our side. There's a life that breaks apart the shackles of guilt and low self-esteem that can hold us back. There's a freedom in forgiveness and a freedom in fresh starts. You and I, we're forgiven. You and I, we are free to live happy and guilt-free lives. We are free to be what God intended us to be, to love and to serve and to forgive others as God has loved, forgiven, and served even us. If the Son sets you free, you are free indeed. Without a doubt, you and I need to keep on reminding ourselves of this truth every day. We might find it difficult to adjust this freedom that Jesus gives us because we like putting on the shackles. We like putting on the chains again and again. Whether willing or just out of habit, we do it. Because sin is as much a part of our lives And we need instead to return to Jesus in faith and in repentance. And he told again and again, and be told again and again, that the Son has set us free. Jesus also gives a stern warning. It's hard hitting. He says, unless you believe that I am who I claim to be, you will die in your sins. That's how deadly serious Jesus is when it comes to the chains of sin. Sin is a killer. It will kill anyone who rejects Jesus and not set free from their shackles. And Jesus offers to break the chains of every person who is a slave to sin and to give them freedom. If the Son sets you free, then you will be free indeed. You will really, really be free. This is an awesome gift. It is worth talking about and celebrating. It is good news. Good news that change lives. I started in Ireland, so I might as well finish there. And this isn't an Irish joke if you think it's setting up one. A young Irish priest was walking from town to town in his rural parish when he sees an old farmer kneeling by the side of the road praying. Impressed, the priest says to the old man, son, what is your name? Paddy, the old man replies. Paddy, you must be very close to God. And Paddy looks up from his prayers at the priest, thinks a moment, and then smiles. You know, Father, he is very fond of me. You know, God is very fond of you. That's grace. And we say thanks be to God. Amen. Our closing hymn today is hymn number 301, Jesus Keep Me Near the Cross. We've seen all four stanzas of this song as well. So please stand as we sing.
Jesus, keep me near the cross, there a precious fountain, free to all a healing stream, flows from Calvary's mountain. Near the cross,
that's beyond the river. Thank you to one of you for being here this morning for our Reformation Sunday. I should also celebrate the Atlanta Braves being back in the World Series for the first time this century. So, hey, yeah, it's been a while, but in the last century that we were there. So anyway, it should be a fun couple of weeks. We get kind of crazy around here when the Braves are in the World Series. So try to get some rest and stay up and watch the games and have a good time. Please remember the dates, December 1st, November 10th. Keep those dates in mind. Hope you can be a part of both of those activities and hope you will come back and be with us again in the days ahead. Our closing benediction is the prayer of St. Francis, who came about 300 years prior to Martin Luther. He came, and a lot would consider him the bigger reformer of the church than Martin Luther was. It's a fascinating theological discussion that Martin Luther should never have been excommunicated, but St. Francis should have been, because he was pushing a whole lot more. And so we close our prayer today with a prayer that he taught us to go out and to be instruments of God's peace. Let us say this together as we leave this place. Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light, and where there is sadness, joy. O Divine Master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive, it is in pardoning that we are pardoned, it is in dying that we are born to eternal life. Amen. Thank you for being here today. Thank you for joining us on the internet today. Please join us again next Sunday when it's All Saints Sunday. Hope that you can join us, be a part of that. We'll start at 9 o'clock next Sunday. Thank you.